And then the Russian guns got closer, and the Germans came in and said, we're going to leave you for the Russians. They'll kill you anyway. Well, about the first of, or the latter part of January, they come in and said, you're going to move. You're going to walk, you're going to ride on a boat, and you're going to ride on a train. This is in the dead of winter, and 1945 was one of the worst winters that Germany had at that time. So I wrote in my notes when I come home that we left on February 2nd. Every book that I've read, and there is one out now, a real good book, two British authors have written this book. It's hard for me to read because it tells about our 86 or 87 day march, living off the land. But I wrote that we left on February 2nd. They said in their book we left on February 6th. I remember we left in a blizzard, in a snowstorm. We had made packs out of shirts, sewed the sleeves to the side, and packed what we had. It wasn't much. I had a pair of long underwear. I had a couple of pair of boxer shorts. I had a couple of pair of socks. I had a pair of gloves. I had had a hat that came in this parcel in Wetzlar, and that sweater, and a GI overcoat. And this is how we started out. And so,
did they give any indication of how long you were supposed to be in transit?
These guards did not know. They did not know. You could see that they didn't know. It was one day at a time for them too. But they at least were able to get decent food. It may have been not real good, but it was decent food compared to what we got. The first march was when I look back, about 54 days in the dead of winter. We slept in barns. When they couldn't find a barn, we slept out in the open. We would pull our, I had a blanket that I had made into a roll. I also buddied with a man by the name of Harold Farrar. I thought he was from Arizona. 2 years ago, I found him. He was in San Diego, California. It took me all those years to find him. And you buddied with somebody to help you do different things, with problems that you had. We never knew how long we were going to walk. We had a kitchen group the first 54 days. It was their job with German personnel to go to a farm and get potatoes or whatever they could get from these farmers. And when we got there, it was usually boiled potatoes or in the boiled potatoes. We ate them out of milk cans. Powdered milk cans came out of Red Cross parcels. I can remember getting in line for potatoes, and you'd get on the end of the line, maybe there'd be some left. I can remember by the time I got to the end of the line, the potatoes that I had were all purple. And I'm saying, ptomaine poisoning, mm-hmm. But they were all purple. But we survived it. I can remember one time we walked around Peenemunde, and they didn't have a place, so we slept out on an open field in the snow. Because we were late, when we got the next day got to our farm that we were supposed to go to, they had steamed some potatoes for us. We got in there after dark. The Germans said, you go up and get potatoes. You couldn't see. We had no lights at night in a barn, no lights. I ate those potatoes, and I didn't realize that they were covered with mold. The next day I was real sick with dysentery, and didn't realize it, that happened.
How did you progress then through this march, particularly with your illness then at that point?
What you did is, you never knew how many would be in the group. You might have 300 or 400, you might have 100, just depending on whether groups would get together. We live from day to day. We all Harold and I talked about the food we were going to have when we got home. I can remember one time we got a Red Cross parcel and we shared it. So we made ourselves a candy bar. Now, this candy bar was made out of powdered milk and prunes and German brown bread. We made it in the carton that the prunes came in because it had a wax edge there. So we got this all done, made it at night, and in the morning it had congealed. And I said to Harold, "Now, Harold, this has got to last for a week." I think it lasted 2 to 2.5 days. We couldn't keep from chopping on it. But I can laugh about it now, but it was something we did,
Were you dealing with any of the German population at this point, or were you seeing them, they seeing you?
Oh yeah, they tried to steer us away from the towns, tried to keep us away whenever possible. You slept in barns. The problem we had in barns is the Germans, their drinking fountain was right in the farmyard. And of course, they always told us to boil the water. Well, the first 54, they didn't provide us with water. First 54 days, we didn't have any, couldn't have any fires, so we couldn't boil any water. I just trying to think of anything else. One town I remember, I had this sweater, and it got covered, it got full of lice. I sat one down one day on the side of a hill, and I picked about 75 lice off of this sweater that didn't even have any sleeves in it. So we got to this German town, and this German civilian, we were bargaining over a fence. This is the closest I got to him. And I think I traded it for 2 eggs and a chunk of bread, my sweater. She wanted that sweater. Well, when I got back, I had a little gob of bread in my stuff, where my stuff was. Somebody had stole it. A fellow American had stole that. That happened once where one of the fellows got caught doing that. And I'll never forget, there was quite a rumpus. The tech sergeant that was in charge of our group took the name and everything, and he says, "You'll be turned in when we get back to the States. You don't steal from a fellow companion who is in the same shape as you are." That's one incident that I remember.
Was there a kind of organization or a hierarchy as you were marching?
Amongst the prisoners?
Yes.
No, not really. The first march, we had the kitchen committee, and I'll never forget, I smile about this because there are things happen on this. We're standing in, there's about 500 of us in a barn, and my buddy and I are up in the hayloft. No lights, you're shoulder to shoulder, tempers are short. If you have to go to the restroom, you have to go and holler at the German. And of course, you might step on somebody's head. But anyway, we standing in roll call, and the tech sergeant was standing in front of me, and he said, "I heard there's some complaints about the kitchen committee." "Oh." He said, "I fired them all. Now I'm going to have a new committee." He was standing directly in front of me, and he said, "Soldier, would you like to work in the kitchen?" And I says, "I sure would. Food." So my job, I laugh about this because things happened afterwards. My job was to stoke 2 80-liter boilers. The Germans had given us a half a cow for 500 people. And we had to cook that. We were supposed to stay there for 3 days. I had to stoke these boilers. So when I got over there, I got the fires going, and the first thing I made myself was a can of barley. It was delicious. I can't eat it today. But I made myself a can of barley, and then I had to go. Mother Nature called. I walked out in the barnyard, and there was some people beckoning to me. It was a whole Polish family that were forced labor, and they gave me some sour bean soup. So I knocked that out. Well, then later in the day,
I knocked that out. Meaning you ate it quickly.
I ate it. Anyway, later in the day, I had to, nature called again, so I went out in there. So I come over there. They had me a slice of German bread with molasses on it. They call it sorghum. It was delicious. Well, about 4 in the afternoon, we were supposed to stay there 3 days. The German Oberfeldwebel come in, and he said, "We're leaving in the morning. Cook everything you've got. And give it to the men." Well, because I had taken on some food, I was had terrible cramps. But I didn't want to lose my job. This is my first day. So gradually I kept getting bent further and further and further. And finally I had to tell the sergeant, "I can't stand up straight." So I said, I have to go back to the barn. So I made myself another can of barley. I didn't eat it. I gave it to my friend Harold. But because of what happened, I had a terrible time with dysentery. I lost my only pair of long underwear. And then I lost my only pants. But I had to wash the pants, so I went up and washed the pants and hung them in the kitchen. On the next morning, I stood roll call in my GI coat and boxer shorts. I laugh about it now, but it was a perfect home for the German lice that they had. From then on, I was in misery. And we had two doctors. One was a British. He had no medicine or nothing for us. If you got dysentery, you'd eat some charcoal. He said, "Don't wash your feet, just pat them. Of course, we didn't have any soap or anything. We never had hot water for 80 some days. And we ran out of paper. I was keeping notes, but we had to use the paper. But
what was the relationship with the guards like in this marching period?
Like I say, they were all older people. I know what I did is I tried to get to the head of the line before we started, because there was always, they're not going to provide transportation for you. So when we started out, I may end up halfway back or three quarters of the way back, but by starting at the head of the line, I didn't have to worry about getting, we walked, and then we took a ride in a ferry boat across Peenemunde Channel there. We did get a boxcar ride about 60 miles, and then they walked us into, I tell you this because it bothers me, they walked us right by Bergen-Belsen. We didn't know at that time, but thousands of people died there. They walked us to Fallingbostel, to prison camp 11B. It was a camp of all nationalities. And every day, the Germans would take out a cart full of boxes with dead bodies in it. They'd bring the cartons back, so you knew they were just burying the bodies in a mass grave or something. But I found out afterwards, and I read this book, that camp was just a staging point for Bergen-Belsen. The very fortunate thing we were living on at that time, about just 800 to 1,000 calories. But we could hear the American guns and the Canadian guns in the West. So we knew the war should be over.
Liberation was on the horizon?
Liberation. The problem we had before that is they pulled the Americans and the British bombed Dresden. They didn't do this. They did this in March, and it's quite an old, from what I understand, famous city, and they bombed that, and thousands of people were killed. Hitler gave orders, we heard, to kill us all, to kill all the American and British prisoners, flyers. Somebody, we understood afterwards, somebody took offense, didn't take offense. They must have said, "No, we can't do that." I heard the term Goering. Goering was the head of the German Air Force. But for me to say it might have been him, but they never, the guards let us know. The guards let us know, hey, orders. But they never did anything. Those were the orders.
Yeah, did you ever get a sense that they would have really followed through with it? Or was it reluctant?
I really just don't think so, because most of them were older people. The problems that we had, the problems you had is the younger people were brought up, and they were, the young men were brought up in the German tradition, and they were anti-aircraft helpers, and you never could tell what these youngsters, 15, 16, 17-year-old youngsters might do, because this was taught to them. They were brought up, you know, during the war, and, you know, so. But the older guards, no. I think they could see the handwriting on the wall that, hey, there was no, you know. We were liberated by the British on May 2nd of 1945. I can remember the British told us the next town we could get some food. We went there.
Let me ask you a question. Did the guards just disappear one day?
The guards just disappeared the day before that. The guards just disappeared before that. I know when we used to march, they would always count us. Whenever they were short, the Oberfeldwebel would order fixed bayonets, and the guards would go in into the straw and the hay and the barns with their, you know, and a lot of times you'd see a bunch of GIs running out because they could hear the guns. Hey, if we hide for a few days, you know, we hide for a few days. But I don't know whether anybody ever in our group made it or not. Falling Bostel, that was quite an experience because they put us in a tent. They put us in a tent, head to foot, and then you just would walk there. What we got for a diet there was one can of dehydrated grass, maybe a couple of potatoes, and maybe a slice of bread. That's what we lived on in that, living in this big tent. I did run into my waist gunner, who would speak German, and he had traded his graduation watch for some bread and I want to say bacon, I forget what it was. And he said, "How you doing, George?" I says, "Hey, I'm surviving." And he gave me a chunk of bread and a chunk of his, I think it was bacon, it seems to me. He gave me a chunk of that. He was the waist gunner on our crew. And he was kind of the head of his group because he could speak German. If he'd have been in our group, he would have been the head of our group because he could deal with the Germans. Yeah. I remember that.
Well, you were liberated and...
We were liberated. And the first day we went to a German home. And the German home kitchen was full of ex-prisoners sitting in their kitchen. And we said, "Where's the Germans?" They had locked themselves in the fruit cellar. So we got some food. The Canadians had run out of food already, so they didn't have any food. We got something from the Germans. I offhand, it was probably just bread products. The next morning, we talked. There was a Polish family there, forced labor. We talked the guy. They had a surrey, a wagon with a horse. We talked to him into taking us to Lunenburg, where we were supposed to meet the British. So we started out in this little surrey, you know, going down the road. All of a sudden, here comes hundreds of GIs running. The Germans are coming, a whole division. And this Polish man was scared to death. He was scared that if it was true and he did this, the Germans, you know. So he took us back, and what it was, we found out later, it was a whole German division had given up to the British, and they were marching right in order into the town of Lunenburg, because the next day when we got to Lunenburg, they were still marching in there. We crossed a pontoon bridge. The British weighed us. They weighed us, and they shipped us out to a little camp waiting for transportation back wherever they were going to get us. So they took us out in trucks, and they gave us, we each had a little pump. We had, two of us had a pup tent. We never got to use it, because within 5 hours, they came with some trucks, they blew a whistle, and they had room, two airplanes had come in, they had room for so many people, just so many. So we got in line, and I'll never forget, I'm standing in line, and the man next to me just keeled over. He just keeled over right flat on his back. And I bent over to help him. While I was doing that, the Germans were counting. And Harold forgot to tell him that I was helping this individual. So when I finally got straightened up, I went to get with this group to get on the airplane. They wouldn't take me. And I said, Harold, how come you didn't tell me? And he felt bad all his life over that. I said, when I found him a couple years ago, I said, Harold, forget it. Forget it. It was all over. Didn't mean nothing to me, but I, at the time, I thought, why didn't you tell him I was helping somebody? But anyway, the next day, I got out. We got to a camp waiting for transportation. I remember a British bomber came in, and he was swamped. I was over there, and I finally got in the airplane. I don't know how many there was. And the pilot came, and he looked up at me, and I'm looking at him. He says, two of you guys got to get out so I can fly this airplane. And I thought, I've gone this far. I'm not going to take a chance. So I got out. A couple of days later, we got into Brussels. Into Brussels, they deloused us. We got on a train, and the Red Ball Express, which was the truck, GI trucks in European theater, we rode on the Red Ball Express into Le Havre. They put us in camps there. Lucky Strike, 20 grand. They put us in there by states. Uh-huh. State, that's how they, if you were from Michigan, they, certain states were in certain area. And we were there probably about 10 days. And then we got a troop ship. And I think I got home about the 10th of June at that time.
Did your family know that you would be in a POW?
My family knew, but something happened here a month ago. You wouldn't believe it. My family was allowed to send me letters, but because I was walking, I never got them. They sent those letters back to my folks, and they were in my mother's cedar chest. And about a month ago, that cedar chest was open, so I got letters that were 60-some years of age. Quite an experience to read. They didn't know, read what mother and dad had, you know. They couldn't say much, but I got those letters about a month and a half ago.
Were you proud of your time in service?
It was a calling that we had to do. And I'll never forget, I did, a lady approached me on an article she wanted to write on Veterans Day for our newspaper. And unbeknownst to me, I said, I've never done this. And I thought about it, and I said, can I write it? She says, no, you can't, I have to write it. And I'm sure there was a reason for it. But the big message is in there, my message is, lest we forget, I had five of my comrades that gave their life. They never had a chance to have a family like I did. Four wonderful boys and a wonderful daughter, 10 wonderful grandkids and 12 great-grandkids, and they've all turned out